That's right, the war is back for part 1C, refuting the feminine Holy Spirit heresy that's being taught out here on YouTube. Now, this is the third video, and I'm hoping that most of you will be able to see the problem with trying to use the grammatical gender of a word to determine the actual gender of a person being spoken of. And as I showed you in the last video, when it comes to the grammar, you can cause all kinds of theological and ideological, hey, those are some pretty nice sized words there for the warrior, problems when you go around taking grammatical gender far beyond reasonable bounds. And I did forget to address something that Monica spoke about in her last video, or in my last video, dealing with her video. And that is, she was talking about the translators and saying, well, why didn't the translators translate the word in such a way that we can tell it's feminine? Well, the answer to that, Monica, is very simple. Because the translators understand the, you know, linguistics and how the Hebrew language works. And it doesn't work that way. Okay? That's why. As I demonstrated from quoting the grammar in the last video. Now, again, word studies are nice, but if we're going to teach the Word of God, and it says to rightly divide or rightly interpret the word of truth, you know, if we're going to rightly divide it, then we need to go beyond these word studies and get the right tools to understand grammar and to understand the language and how it works. Word studies will not do it, as I've demonstrated so far. And one of the things I did want to mention, you know, for all of you guys out there who are seeing this video and understand, or maybe you're friends with Monica, some of you still have her, you know, on your friend list. She's not on mine anymore, but please spread these, my videos about this, as far and wide as you like, okay? And if you want to, I don't know, what do you call it, download the video, my video, and put it on your channel, you can do that. You have my permission, as long as you don't, you know, mess things up and start going crazy. But I do want this message to get out there so that people can see the other side of the story, because a part of removing someone from your subscriber list and friend list is so that others who come to your channel can't view, you know, your channel and your videos readily from your channel. So just spread the word and let people know that the warrior is dealing with the heresy. All of it, where, you know, feminine Holy Spirit, wife of God, all of that will be exposed for the heresy that it is. Now, here's another clip where Monica takes John 3 and goes wild with it, with the gender stuff. Check it out.
We gain new insight into familiar passages about the Holy Spirit, such as John chapter 3, where Jesus is talking to Nicodemus and he says, I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born again. How can a man be born when he is old? Nicodemus asked. Surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb to be born. Jesus answered, I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. Now, most of us, when we read this passage historically, because we have always spoken of the Holy Spirit in terms of he and him, because we have not had a defined family relationship that the Holy Spirit has with the Father and the Son, we have not really been able to grasp what this scripture is saying to us. When we see this in the light of the fact that God describes the Holy Spirit as being feminine all throughout the Old Testament, then we see the possibility that when Nicodemus is talking about a mother's womb, that that's exactly what Jesus is talking about in the Spirit as well, when he says you have to be born of the Holy Spirit. And that's very different from trying to relate to a God that is giving birth to us that is male, that is somehow male in our mind.
All right, you've seen the clip. Now let's get into it. Here's the problem. Okay, it's not good new insight when that insight is heretical and problematic, because first of all, in John chapter 3, Nicodemus is mistaken, all right, about his conception of what it is to be born again. It's clear from the context. He's talking about, well, can you enter again in your mother's womb be born? So that's the first thing. Nicodemus is mistaken, and Jesus is correcting him. Okay? So the fact that Nicodemus is talking about a mother's womb has no bearing on what Jesus is talking about in terms of being born of the Spirit. All right? How do I know that? Well, let's go to a passage, and I'm going to make reference to others, but here's one passage here. Now, if you're going to try to argue that the Holy Spirit is female because of birth terminology, which is symbolic and metaphorical, then let's see what you can come up with when you try to argue that way. Okay, Holy Spirit is female because we're talking birth terminology. This is the reasoning that she's using. And she's not the only one. I mean, there are others that have espoused this doctrine in the past. This is not new stuff, but we can get into that at another point in time. John chapter 1, verse 13, but I'm going to read 12 and 13. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become the children of God, to those who believe in his name. Verse 13, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. Wait a minute. Born of God. So I guess God now must be feminine because we have birth language used of him. No. No. Okay, we can find the same thing in 1 John 3 and 9, 1 John 4 and 7, 1 John 5 and 1. All examples of birth language being used of God. It's just simply another way of saying God is the creator. He doesn't have to be feminine in order to give birth, because God is not human and is not restricted to our conceptions of birth. You know, on the human biological level, men don't give birth, okay? But God can, as the creator. He can do miraculous things like virgin birth, you know. So what Monica's doing is just espousing a pagan version of Christian doctrine, where the pagans, you know, when you read most of your pagan birth stories, it's always, or should I say usually, a male figure or a male deity coming together with a female deity and creating a child. And if when you go into one of the other videos, she even basically argues that that's what's happening with Jesus and the Holy Spirit. And I'm going to get into that too, to explain why that's fallacious. But basically, her problem is that she is not paying attention to the details of Scripture. She's ignoring the details of the language of Hebrew. And that causes the problems that she's gone into. Okay, grammatical gender does not always equal natural or actual gender. And so, even though we can say that God may possess the qualities of male and female, God never, ever, in Scripture, uses feminine pronouns of himself. Never. And when God decided to become a man in Jesus, well, he became a man. Now, he could have become a woman, but he made that choice. All I'm saying is we've got to stick to Scripture. This concludes this first series of videos. We're going on to another series after this. See you then.